Should women be entitled to paid menstrual leave every month? The private member's bill tabled in Parliament by Congress MP Ninong Ering has sparked a debate. The bill argues that women should be entitled to paid leave every month and it will attract more women to the workforce. It also seeks better facilities at the workplace for women during menstruation. Now, this has been a raging debate amongst startups in India. Digital media company Culture Machine supports menstrual leave and even launched a campaign video that went viral. A few other companies also allow menstrual leave for women. In fact, global sports apparel maker Nike was the first to set the ball rolling. Nike allowed menstrual leave more than a decade ago. Many countries, including the likes of Japan, Indonesia, South Korea and Taiwan, have legislation that allows for paid menstrual leave for many decades now. But critics of the bill argue that instead of encouraging women to join the workforce, this bill would discourage businesses from hiring women. India fares poorly when it comes to women in the workforce. The World Bank ranks India at 120 out of 131 nations. Some estimates show that women constitute only 26 to 28% of the workforce in the country. So the big question is, will this menstruation benefit bill prove to be a gift or a deterrent to women in the workforce? Joining us now on this discussion on the bill are Devlina Mazumdar from Culture Machine, Sairi Chahal of Shiro's, Sonal Arora from Team Lease Services. Appreciate you joining us. Devlina, let me start by asking you, I would imagine that you would welcome this private member's bill. Private member bills don't go very far, so let's not get our expectations up. But the fact that this bill has now been moved by a Congress MP in the Lok Sabha, which suggests that there be menstrual paid leave for women in the workforce, most critics seem to suggest that this is in fact going to be a deterrent to getting more women to join the workforce. This is going to be another obstacle that women will now have to face as the screening process where maternity benefits, etc., already stacked up against them. How do you respond to that?
While I do not have major expectations out of the bill, but let me tell you, I'm very happy that somebody thought about this and proposed this in the parliament. And I really, really want to convey my thanks to Mr. Ering for doing this. Now, let me just tell you that this is not just a policy. Why we launched this in Culture Machine is because we have a healthy female employee representation, about 34% in our organization. It's a young organization. So for us, it was very important to recognize the several needs of employees working in this organization. And that's why we thought of this, trying to recognize their needs. And it's an optional leave. So if you check the data globally, then...
How many people have availed of the leave, Devlina?
Exactly. So
how many people have availed of the leave since you started this in July last year?
So since July, month on month, on an average, there has been a 7 to 8% of female population who have applied for this leave. And our systems are all automated. So it's straight data coming from your automated system. So which proves that people are not misusing this policy. They are availing this leave based on their biological needs. And if you also check the global data point, 7 to 8% of women go through this condition called endometriosis, in which it becomes a very menstruation becomes a painful journey for them. And they brave it to work with all the pain.
I completely agree with you.
Yeah.
I completely agree with you, Devlina. Since you brought up the fact that endometriosis is a medical condition, one would argue, why can't you take a sick leave in that case on the days that you face the debilitating pain and cannot come into work? Why do you need to then make it mandatory to have certain days as paid leave for menstruation?
Absolutely. Why not a sick leave or why not a casual leave for that matter? But the idea here is also to break the taboo. Why do you want to hide behind a sick leave when you're pregnant? Do you apply for sick leave or pregnancy leave? Let us accept menstruation is a natural process. So why not a menstrual leave? There is no harm in applying for a menstrual leave, coming out in the open and talking about it, right? Rather than faking it or braving your way to work. And also when you talk about productivity, you know, labor force participation in India has been falling drastically. So from a 37% in 2004, yes, it's become a 28% representation in 2006. So in spite of taking all the possible measures and most progressive, steps taken by various organizations, if this is falling, then there needs to be, something that needs to be done to ensure there is a healthy representation so that more women come to work.
Well, the question now is whether things like menstrual leave will in fact make matters worse, which is the argument of the critics of the bill. But I'll come back to you in just a second, Devleena. Let me go to our other panelists as well. Priyanka Chaturvedi, spokesperson of the Congress Party, here with us. Priyanka, it is a member of your party that has moved this private member's bill in the Lok Sabha, saying that menstrual leave should be made mandatory for women to encourage their participation in the workforce and give them a better environment, a better working environment. As a woman, and I'm not asking you this as a politician or as a member of the Congress Party, as a woman, do you support this bill?
So I speak as a woman over and above my own position in the organization. While I consider this entire private member's bill in good spirit and in good faith and a laudable attempt, however, as a woman, I stand on the path of disagreement simply because women who are aspiring to be in the labor force have to aspire on the basis of inclusive policies, not on the basis of exclusive policies made on the basis of their gender and on the basis of their biological process. When we talk about removing taboo around periods, we must first start with women using hygienic methods of during their periods. Then we talk about policies that ensure that women do not face any kind of workplace harassment. So these are my issues. And we must understand one thing. When maternity leave was passed, maternity bill was passed, we all as women applauded it and we all appreciated the move. But we must understand, by creating these policies, we are only distancing women from joining the workforce, because many HR companies may not come forward and say it, but they try to ensure that women...
But that's not necessarily the case globally. I understand the concern that you're raising, but that's not the case globally. Scandinavian countries, for instance, which have mandated representation of women, have in fact done much better on all parameters.
Yes, I'm absolutely in agreement with you. When we have more women participation in labor force, in policy making space, and in every space available to men, should also have equal access for women. And that is what Scandinavian countries have been aspiring towards and working towards. Their policies are inclusive policies. They're not policies created exclusively for women. So whether it is in the policy-making space where we need to make space for women, whether it is in our labor workforce where we need to create space for women, it is about equal opportunities and equal access. It shouldn't become about creating more gated communities for women to be able to work in. So let's aspire for equal opportunities rather than creating these exclusive policies, which will end up ensuring that HR, when they recruit people, they keep women out of their minds and out of their area of recruitment.
Okay. And that is a valid concern and a valid fear that a lot of people are expressing on this bill. So let me take that across to somebody who understands the HR business. Sonal Arora from Team Lease joins us as well. Sonal, you've heard what both Devleena has had to say and what Priyanka Chaturvedi is saying. Do you believe that this will in fact further worsen the case to employ more women, get more participation of women in the workforce? Will this weigh on the mind of an employer as he looks at hiring a prospective employee if she were to be a woman and would then have to avail of menstrual benefits outside of just the maternity benefits that are mandated by law?
Absolutely. And while, I appreciate what Devleena and her organization are doing, I'm definitely, doubtful that all organizations across country will think in the same spirit. I mean, my personal views on this subject apart, it may not be accepted or verbalized by organizations, HR folks within the companies, or why just blame HR? I mean, at the end of the day, the business guys take the call on recruitment. As a hiring manager, when somebody is hiring, if there are so many,
what are the practical challenges this throws up?
See, the practical challenges that will throw up is that there are two aspects. Let's be practical about it, that organizations are responsible for results and organizations also have a balancing to do between all people within the team. So one is when you are responsible for output, and if you you know, sort of have a candidate in front of you who's likely to be taking extra time off 2 days a week, you know, or 2 days a month, or you know, it's not the same thing as maternity benefit amendment. There, it's you know, twice in a person's lifetime. Not every woman will get pregnant at the same time and want to take leave. This is here we are talking about something which is going to be applicable to every female employee. As hiring managers, HR managers, when they're sitting in interviewing candidates, they will think about these things that, okay, if I have, you know, so many people in my team going on leave or wanting, or at least having the option of availing the leave, how will I balance the load? You know, how who will do the extra work? Organizations may not say it openly, but I trust you, you know, when you talk to them informally, when recruiters are making that decision, it will weigh on their mind. And I also completely agree, as an individual and as a woman, with what Priyanka said. We have to create inclusive policies for women at workforce.
Yes.
Special treatment is not going to get the, you know, India make India a better place for female employment. It is just not going to work.
But you know, since we're talking about inclusive policies for women, and Sairi Chair, let me come to you with this, because very often maternity benefits are seen as privileges that are granted to women, but this is a fact of life. I mean, especially in a patriarchal society like India, the job of bringing up a child is centered around the role that the woman plays in the home. I mean, you've had to deal with this on many levels, Sairi, in what you do. So I wanted to get your thoughts on how do you balance this? I mean, this is well-intentioned. Everybody on this panel is making legitimate, well-intentioned arguments, but how do we balance the practical challenges with the reality?
So I think it's absolutely well-intentioned, but at the same time, I think we got to look at data and we got to look at the stark reality of India. It seems to me that we are running away from the hard issues that face us, and clearly, I think we have much more severe and fundamental issues at, you know, at gender disparity level rather than this. So while this is a great step, it's also a step in isolation, and only this is not going to fix our, fix our gender balance ratios, right? We know that we can't run away from the truth of education, safety, domestic violence, healthcare, reproductive rights, and patriarchy, which we refuse to even acknowledge as a country, and it keeps on going further and further. So I think we can't look at this issue in isolation, and everybody who's involved, whether it's policy or business, we got to sort of do it in the right spirit. So a lot of this can be affirmative action from the industry, but a lot of policy needs to come from ground up.
Okay, so you're saying it should be affirmative action left to industry, let companies design more inclusive policies, as Culture Machine has shown us. They've taken the way forward on this particular matter. We've got other companies that have brought in things like paternity leave, etc. Devleena, respond to the point that Sairi is making. Why don't we leave this to individual companies to look at the ways of being able to address these issues? And Sairi, I think, is also making another important point that, you know, is this really what we should be prioritizing over the other many battles that women face in the workforce?
So, Shireen, people are free to come.
Does this distract us? Does this distract us?
Certainly not. It's just a step taken in a particular way or a direction. So there are various issues. Right. It depends on you which issue you pick up and run with it, and try to create an impact.
Yeah. But not if it's mandated by law, Devleena. Then the option is not with... But not if it's mandated by law. Then you lose that option, right?
So the thing is, like, the leave is optional. Our petition is just to make the government aware, the country aware, the workplace is aware that this could be an issue. And let them be mindful about this. It's up to them whether they want to implement or not. So it's a very simple gesture. It's a policy which ensures that women don't have to brave it to work unnecessarily when they have such conditions. And, you know, my data points are proving that people are not misusing. So we are only talking about women with painful or distressful menstrual days. This is not an invitation to holiday, very clearly. Yeah. And this is, we are just as an organization.
Yes, I think.
Yeah.
Sure. yeah, well, you know, what might work for you as an organization, the problem then is if it's mandated by law, what is it then? What are the unintended consequences of that? I think those are some of the concerns being raised. Wrap-up comments from each of our panelists. Priyanka, a quick final word from you on how do we go forward with balancing the practical challenges as well as ensuring that we do, in fact, get a more participative workforce?
Absolutely. We need to create an environment, work environment, which is inclusive of women, not excludes them from the entire process. Our policies need to work towards that. HR policies of various companies need to ensure that women are equally represented in their companies, on their boards. So this is something that needs to be coming from various corporate houses, companies, and not forced down on them as policies. So that is the only way forward if we have to work.
Yeah, but you know, just my counter to that, Priyanka, my counter to that is that it was only when it was mandated by the regulator that we actually saw corporate India bring more women onto boards. So this business of affirmative action and hoping that good behavior will sort of be nurtured by organizations is not necessarily the case. At least we haven't seen that when it comes to women representation. It needed a law for better women representation. Even on boards.
Absolutely. Considering when women are making this a talking point and this has become the focus of everyone's attention, whether it is about women's representation in the parliament or women's representation on the boards of companies, this is going to be a talking point, and I'm very certain that every HR company wouldn't want policies thrust on them. They would ensure that they make policies which include women workforce and make policies which also keep in mind the biological processes and the need for women to take a maternity leave when they have to.
Okay. Sonal, final comments from you.
So I think my final comments would be that we should not equate all the issues on the same platform. Maternity benefit, you know, is not the same thing as a menstrual leave. That is a requirement which is expected, over a period of time, twice in a lifetime. Doesn't happen to everyone. So and also there, there is an element of planning that a company can do. So looking at how things work practically, I'm glad if it's working well in Devrina's company, people are not misusing it. But I think the data size is too small for us to be able to comment whether it will work effectively across the board. And also, I think we have to also understand one aspect that we are talking, even if we talk of entire corporate India, it's a very small universe for us because 90% of women work in the informal sector, in the agricultural sector. So really, looking at the 10% of Indian population? What about that 90%? Something has to be done about them also.
Sure.
think that's another battle that we need to
take. I think There is merit in all of those issues that you raise. I think we've got that conversation started. Sairi, 10 seconds, final comment from you.
Right. So I think if I had to pick my battles, I think I would prioritize issues of reproductive health, menstrual health, mass market, because I think those are much pressing issues and really need people at the helm to take more charge.
All right, ladies, we'll have to leave it there. Sairi Chahal, Sonal, Devlina and Priyanka Chaturvedi, appreciate you joining us here to talk about, the concerns as well as getting the conversation started on this private member bill that's been moved in the Lok Sabha by a Congress MP seeking menstrual paid leave for women in India. We will slip into a short break, but on the other side, the legal grey area surrounding cryptocurrencies. Can you go to jail for trading in bitcoins? We'll answer that when we return.